Today we are going to discuss implementation of KNN using R. And before that, we'll just do a quick recap of how this KNN algorithm works. So let's say there are two independent variables, x1 and x2, and it's a three-class classification problem. And like any classification problem, this is an unlabeled data, this one which shows up with a question mark, and we want to find out that which class this belongs to. So our step one is find k nearest neighbors. So in this example, we have taken the value of k equal to 3. So the three nearest neighbors are encircled by this red circle. And we see that out of these three neighbors, two are duck and one is hen. And so our conclusion is that as the majority of the class is duck, the question mark instance is also going to be a duck. Okay, so by this principle, KNN works. Now there are a couple of design issues. How many neighbors to choose? So in this example, we have picked up 3, but that is arbitrary. And when we talk about neighborhood, right, we want to find out the distance with other observations, because on the basis of that only, we can say that which are nearest and which are not. So which distance measure to use? Now how many neighbors? You have to do a trial and error method. Which distance measure, it's based on, you know, what is the type of data, input data you have, right? So if it is real valued, you can use distance measures like Euclidean Manhattan. If it is integer valued or even categorical valued, you can use a Hamming distance. If it is Boolean valued, you can use Dice, Jaccard, and all these distance measures, okay? How Euclidean distance works? Here is a quick example. So let's say there are three customers, C1, C2, and C3, and they are described by only two attributes, their age and salary. Okay, so the first record, if you see, belongs to customer C1, the second record belongs to customer C2, and so on and so forth. Now, if I want to find out the distance between C1 and C2, right? So we are just going to use our old Euclidean formula that we have learned in high school. So it is going to be x1 minus x2 square, so 30 minus 30 square plus 35,000 minus 35,001 square, okay? So distance of C1, C2 is 1 over here, 0 comes from here, 1 comes from here, and distance of C1 and C3 is also 1, okay? Now, one question or one problem when we are dealing with distance algorithm is that it treats all the features uniformly, okay? All attributes get the same importance. So essentially we are saying that difference of 1 year in age and difference of 1 rupees or 1 INR in salary is equivalent, right? But if you think of a percentage scale, 1 rupee in 35,000 is a small percentage, right? Whereas 1 out of 30 is quite big. Even, you know, more realistically, if you think of that one person, her age has grown by 1 year and he has got a salary rise of 1 rupees, you can understand that these are not compatible at all. Okay, so what do you do for that? Actually, you have something like normalizing or standardizing the data so that all attributes get equal importance, okay, in spite of their range. All right, so how do you do that? So one technique is you can take the value of x, subtract the mean and divide by standard deviation. So this is something we do very normally when we convert a normal variable to a standard normal variable. So one catch is, however, that you assume that the distribution is normal, right? So you are making an assumption about the distribution. The second one, which we call as normalization, is more generic. So you find the minimum value of that variable, you subtract from the current customer's value, and then in the denominator, you have max minus mean, okay? So let's look at an example of normalization. So let's say you have these values in age, okay, 30, 35, 40, 25, and 67. So your first step is finding the minimum and maximum value. And then let's say I want to convert this value, right, normalize this value, then I'm going to do a 30 minus 25 by 67 minus 25. So it will be converted to 0.1. If I apply this across all the values, then I will see that I get values between 0 to 1. One critical observation is that the minimum value is scaled to 0 and the maximum value is scaled to 1. Okay, so this is what will happen irrespective of, you know, what value range it is. It is in 20s or thousands, it will be mapped between 0 to 1. Okay. Now, let's start with our experiment. So, we need to import this library class, and we are going to do the read this CSV file. The name of that is transfusion. So, let's import that and look at the data. Okay, so here is how the data looks like. So, you have four variables R, F, M, and T, and then you have a attribute called as donated. So, this is a blood transfusion data. Basically, based on some of the attributes like how recently that person has donated blood, what frequency, you know, how much monetary unit worth of blood, and so on and so forth, you are going to predict whether that person will donate for a particular camp or not. So this is the problem. This is the classification problem, binary classification problem, and these are your input attributes. Okay, and if you look at a summary, if you would just be interested, you can look at what are the different mean values and etc. You can also quickly check the dimension, which is also apparent from the summary though. So you do a dim transfusion. Okay, so I missed the S. Now if you run this, so it tells you that there are 748 rows and 5 columns. 5 columns out of 4, they are independent variables, the predictors, and then the last one is the target variable. So for normalizing, we are going to write a quick R function. Okay, and basically what we are doing is we are finding the minimum value of x and then, you know, dividing by that max minus mean, whatever we discussed. So we are creating a function, and if you look at the way R defined function, so this is the name of the function. You need to use this keyword and you need to tell that how many attributes or how many input arguments you are going to pass. Very interestingly, in R, you don't need to mention the data types, right? So let me just run this, and let me now show you the effect on this vector x. Okay, so let me run this. So x has values 10, 20, 25, 56, 30, 12. I'm normalizing it, and I can actually run and see what are the values of y. So you'll see that, you know, it maps nicely between 0 to 1. So 0 corresponds to 10, the minimum value, and 1 corresponds to 56. One other thing which is important is, which is different from how other programming language works, is that you have an array of elements, right? So typically you will handle that with a loop. Okay, so it is not required to do that way in R. So you can directly apply this operation, so it will happen element wise, okay, much faster. Secondly, there is another very useful function called as ilapply. So what I now want to do is I want to apply this function over all the columns. So typically this will result into multiple loops in conventional programming. Not that way in R, it is much more efficient. So what we are going to say is ilapply on which dataset transfusion, which columns, column 1 to 4. So this colon indicates that we are going, starting from 1, we are going all the way to 4. And which function we are applying? We are applying normalize. And we are storing that in a different variable named as trans underscore m. So let me just run this part. So normalization is done. Now if I look at this data quickly, you should see that the values are mapped between 0 to 1. So this is what we wanted. Okay. All right. Now let's break it up into training and testing. So you already know why we break into training and testing. And what we are going to do over here is, so we are using a function called a sample. The first attribute is that how many samples I am going to pick up, okay, and or rather from what range I am going to do the sample. And this second attribute is that how many, what is the size of the sample, okay? So how many samples I want? I want that many sample as there are rows in this data set. Okay, we could have used the original transfusion also because they have same number of rows. n row basically returns the number of rows that data frame has got. Okay, and it is sampling with replacement. So replace equal to true. What is probability of 0.6 and 0.33? So basically, you know, it is going to generate 748 elements. So which are only going to have two values, 1 and 2. Out of that, having 1, the probability is going to be 0.67 and probability of 2 is going to be 0.33. What we are next going to do is, we are going to use this 1 and 2 marker to split that into training and testing. Okay, so let me just run this. So look at this code. So we are, so this is the row part. We are saying pick only those things in training where this indicator is 1, which should be, which supposedly should be in 2/3 of the row indices, and pick column 1 to 4, and similarly, you know, for the test. And we are picking up the target variable also similarly, right? So here it is the input variable, so 1 to 4. Here it is the output or target variable, so 5. So that's the idea. Now let's run this. Okay. Now let's go and feed the KNN model. Okay. So KNN, you know, takes attributes like or arguments like what is the training set, what is the testing set, where is the class label, and what is the value of k. So here we have taken a value of k equal to 5, but it is not necessary that 5 is the best value. So we are going to see how to do a trial and error and find a good value of k. So initially what we are just going to see is that we are using this KNN function, and what it returns is the predicted value of a test set. Okay. And you know that we apply or check our classifier's accuracy on the testing set because we don't want our models to memorize or overfit, right? And we are going to look, form a table and look at it like a confusion matrix. Okay, so let's do that. So test labels is the actual labels and test rep are the predicted labels. Okay, so here is how my confusion matrix looks like. Right, and if I want the classification accuracy for that, there are several functions, but again we have written one for our own. So what we have done is we are actually taking this table as an input, and we are, you know, we are going through row by row, and we are finding out the sum where the row index and column index is same. So we are basically taking the principal diagonal. So that's what we are doing. You see, sum plus T1ii. Right, so row index and column index is the same, and then this is taken in a variable sum, and we are dividing it by the number of observations we have got. So let me create this function quickly, and then we can apply that on this T1 and print the value. So hopefully we'll get a classification accuracy. Yes, so we are getting a classification accuracy of 74.16 on the testing set. How do I select optimal value of k? As I said, it is trial and error. So maybe I will take different values of k starting from 1 to 50, look at where my testing accuracy is better, and I will take that value of k as the best where I get a best accuracy. So what we are doing over here, you know, pay attention carefully. So first, we are creating a simple list having value 1 to 50. So this we are going to use as an input as to KNN. And then we are initializing an empty array, okay, which we'll be using to hold the accuracy of all the different iterations. Now we are running this loop. So the loop in R has this format, alin 1. This is to be read as 1 to length of neighbor. So here this length of neighbor is 50. Okay, so this loop will be executed 50 times. And for each time, I'm going to run KNN. What is going to change? I am going to change this k equal to l. So for the first iteration, it will run with a value of k equal to 1. In the last iteration, it will run with a value of 50. And for each one of them, I am creating this table. I am applying the function that we created earlier, the CA function, and we are storing that in an array. So let me run this. So the KNN model has been run 50 times. Okay. Now let me look at the content of the array. Yeah, so all classification accuracies we can see. Now what we are going to do is we are going to column bind them. Okay, column bind. So I want to create a nice data frame which has the number of numbers and number of neighbors and the corresponding accuracies. So let me run this and let me also look at the data frame. Okay, so if you run this, you will see that, you know, these are the different neighboring values and corresponding accuracies. Let me also draw a line plot using ggplot, which is one of the best, you know, visualizing packages in R. Okay, so we are going to import ggplot2, and then you know, ggplot brings it layer by layer, right? So we want to first draw a line and also identify the point. So that's why what we have done is we have used the data, and then there is an aesthetic layer where you need to mention the x variable and the y variable. Then you have this plus sign. So this is what I was telling you, layer by layer. We are saying that create a line using these points and also highlight the points. Okay. So let me run this. And you know, this is the curve looks like. And interestingly, you see that there is quite a bit of variation, right? So when I started with maybe a small value of k equal to 1, it was less than 73%, right? And it goes all the way up to 80%, right? Or more than 80% when we have maybe k equal to 30, 31, like that. So there is quite a, you know, quite a lot of effect. So there is, you can see that there is a 10% or, you know, 7 to 8% difference when we get optimal value of k, right? So this is the way you can find the value of k. And this is available as a public notebook, right? So which I will provide in the video description. And if you have liked it, if you have learned something, please do, you know, subscribe, like, and give your comments. Thanks guys for watching this.